about 25 or 30 of you in the waiting room there on Facebook. This is our first Sunday of August, August 1st, 2021. We're glad that you're joining us here today. Today is our communion Sunday, so more of that than advice in advance. If you don't have one of our prepackaged communion cups at home, singing a solo or something, but
I think we're
that'll probably
here. Thank you, everybody, for being up here. And Kate's with us on the end, too. She's going to be doing the handbell thing here, too, just to get you all in the spirit, right, of that, too. All right, Sunshine in My Soul Today. We're going to do the first and the fourth verses, I believe, what Bill told me.
You're right.
Good morning, everyone. A really, really big welcome to you all. Can you all hear me?
Can you hear me okay?
Can you hear me all right? Do we have any first-time visitors in person or online this morning? Even if you're watching this as a recording later in the week, please comment that this is your first time so we can honor you as our guest. And our next church work day is next Saturday, August the 7th, at 8:30 in the morning.
Amen.
Be sure to check the calling club names for today. Each week, three random names will appear under our calling club section in the bulletin. Reach out saying hi to encourage our friends with a call or card. This week, let's remember Roy Rule, Dolores Bensi, and Lila. Pastor Wendell will begin scheduling in-home visits with communion with several of our shut-in folks. Let him know if you would like to participate in any of these efforts. And several have expressed interest in reviving the handbell choir. Speak with Laura or Kay Hosmer if you are interested in this ministry.
We got Laura upstairs and Kay is right here. Go ahead and wave at him, Kay. And do you have any practices set up
here?
Handbell choir, whoops. Handbell choir first practice the 2nd of September, okay. Our next breakfast and blessings is slated for August the 14th from 8:30 to 10 in the morning. See Jan or Carol if you are interested in helping with this ministry. And the Lake County Fair starts this Friday, August the 6th at noon and runs through Sunday, August the 15th in the evening. We need your help managing the high school parking lot. Shifts begin at noon. Several day and evening shifts are still available. A sign-up sheet with days and time slots is posted on the back narthex bulletin board. Feel free to double up with the buddy system if that works best for you. Thank you in advance for helping. And our Rusty Nail Crossing concert event It is going to be on August the 22nd at 10 in the morning. Invite those friends or family who would not normally attend a regular church service. We will give everyone a great big St. John's welcome.
Amen.
Plan to come. And our 2021 stewardship campaign entitled Together We Can Make a Difference is slated for September. We need your support and commitment beginning this new fiscal year. Please generously invest your time, talent, and financial support for the Lord at St. John's UCC. Are there any more announcements?
Any announcements that we're forgetting? Welcome. The Grangers are with us. You guys are North or South Carolina? I forget.
North.
North Carolina. All right, good deal. That's where my youngest daughter lives. She just moved somewhere. She's in the Raleigh area. Hey, you know how it is. Your kids grow up, they leave the house. The youngest is there. Wherever they're at. You know, they just moved, so Lewisburg or something is one that I think is where they moved. Remember that? That's probably where she was. I guess she's going to shut up and move on. But welcome, Grangers. Welcome, Grangers, with us today. You guys are special people. Lauren?
I just want to ask the congregation, we do have Rusty Nails Crossings coming August 22nd, and we're going to have our church picnic that day.
We actually are not going to have the picnic. Or we've had some circumstance come up. We're not going to have it, but we will have a regular fellowship time afterwards.
Are we doing food or luncheon?
No, whatever the regular thing is we do, that's what we're going to do.
Okay,
I didn't get a chance to talk to you about that. I apologize. I apologize. All right, anything else? We're excited about the group coming. They're going to have the whole service that day, and it'll be a good day.
Please join me in the call to worship. We are called to worship today by reciting the Apostles' Creed in unison, and you will find that in the inside front cover of the hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one holy universal Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen.
3:5 To God be the glory. That's why we're here today. To give him praise for what he has done for us. Never, ever, ever lose sight of that. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about him always. What can we do for him always? 1 and 3, Laura.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Please join me in the invocation. Welcome to this place where God has been, is, and always will be.
Welcome to this place where we find God's love and truth.
Welcome to this place where all is made ready by our Lord.
Welcome to this place where we leave our brokenness at His feet.
Amen.
Let's say hi to one another with the passing of peace.
Thank you. Breakfast and Blessing is back in full swing. meeting downstairs twice a month. And it's a good group of folks that we have coming out for that and helping. And there's usually a sign-up sheet on that far bulletin board if you'd like to be a part of that ministry on a Saturday morning. For being in ministry, I mean, just any witnesses?
Our scripture reading for this morning is from Galatians 3, 1 through 14. This is faith or works of the law. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified. I would like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law, or by believing what you heard? Are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by means of the flesh? Have you experienced so much in vain, if it really was in vain? So again I ask, does God give you his Spirit and work miracles among you by the works of the law or by your believing what you heard? So also Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Understand then that those who have faith are children of Abraham. Scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you, so those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse, as it is written, "Cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law." Clearly, no one who relies on the law is justified before God, because the righteous will live by faith. The law is not based on faith. On the contrary, it says, the person who does these things will live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a pole. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Amen and amen. Amen.
Bonnie, thank you so much. Great job reading as always. And we've got, just so you know here, we've got Dean Downey is with us today. I've got Dean Downey's card here from his, when he passed away just a little bit ago, using that as a Bible marker. It helps me when I put those cards in my Bible and I think about those folks that have passed, and think about their families and friends, and it causes me to pray for them. And Dean was one of those guys where when you see him, he'd always bring a smile to my face. And so I want to see his card here and think about him and the influence he had here at the church. It still makes me smile. So God bless you, Dean. We know you're looking down on us today. And we just pray that faith has become sight for him. All right, our summer series. We've been doing a series of summer messages, and in July they were all kind of dealing with freedom and all of that. And we were in Galatians chapter 1 last week, finishing up the freedom series. And I'd ask Bonnie just to continue and read chapter 3. And I'm going to refer back to a couple verses. And Galatians is a phenomenal book. It's a book of freedom. It's a book of instruction from God. It's a book where we need to hear what God has to say through the Apostle Paul. Paul is encouraging that church in Galatia to throw off the bonds and not go back into the bondage of traditions, the bondage of believing that they could keep the law. Does everybody know what the law is? When you think about the Old Testament, what the law was, it was 10-something. 10 commandments. That's the basis or the root of the law. Now, the Jewish folks back then, they had, God had given them those 10 commandments as the basis of the law. And how many of you here today have kept all the 10 commandments? Well, at least we have no liars in the church today. Can't keep them, can we? Because we are imperfect people. We're human. We just love to use that phrase, well, I'm just human. Human means that we mess up. That's the euphemism for that. We mess up. But the Jewish leadership in the religious realm back then, they built upon the Ten Commandments that God gave them, and they had over 600 and some other laws that you had to keep in order to be a faithful religious follower in the Jewish faith. Now, 10's hard enough, right? Now, we all fell short on God's 10, but when you start adding in all these other laws, I mean, they were some silly things like you could only walk 30 steps on a Sunday, you couldn't walk any more steps, and you had to stop there and wait till the next day, they were just crazy things that they would formulate laws about. You can only eat this, you can only eat that. Just all these different things that they would formulate laws that some would come traditions and things like that. But God gave us the 10, and we can't keep those. And that's what Paul is telling the Galatians here. He says, we are saved. If you know the Lord as your Savior today, you've come to that point because you've trusted in the finished work of Jesus Christ on a cross similar to this that we call Calvary. You've trusted that when Jesus Christ died on that cross, he was dying for your sins. Each one of us makes it personal because the relationship with him on the cross has to be personal. I have to receive his forgiveness for my sins. I can't do it for you. You can't do it for me. We can't do it for our kids or our grandkids or our relatives or anybody else. It's a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's what Christianity is this morning. It's a relationship with a risen Lord. A risen Lord. A Lord that has paid the price, who has given us the freedoms that we've been talking about here the last few weeks. And as we listen to God, to know and to understand that he doesn't want us, like Paul was telling this church in Galatia, he doesn't want us to go back into bondage and trying to do things that are not beneficial to trusting Christ as our Savior. Trusting him with our choices. Trusting him with our decisions. Trusting him when the outcome doesn't always measure up with what we think it should be. What a great, great passage of scripture Bonnie read for us here. But Paul, when he tells those Galatians, there in that first verse that she read, when he says, you're foolish Galatians. Sometimes, I got to admit to you, sometimes I'm foolish. I do foolish things. I say foolish things. I act foolishly. I just mess up. I mean, it's something, I guess it's all a part of the being human thing. But the Galatians, as Paul is saying, foolish Galatians, why are you doing this? Why are you believing these people that have come and told you that you have to keep all of these laws in order to get to God? When the grace of God has already given you the freedom that you need. I want to take you back just a few verses there in Galatians chapter 2. When you talk about the works of the law, we're talking about keeping the Old Testament, the Ten Commandments. In chapter 2 and verse 16, Paul prefaced what we just read with this. He says, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ that we might be justified by faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Now, I was in Bible college all those years ago. They said, you know, some things in the Bible you interpret literally, and some you interpret symbolically, and some you interpret figuratively. I'm not going to get into a big rigmarole about all those things, but my mama always told me that plain talk is easily understood. If you want to know something about somebody, yeah, you go to the source and you ask them. And Paul here is going to the source here of the Lord, and he's telling this church at Galatia in chapter 2, verse 16, we just read that, for by the works of the law shall no flesh, no one, no human being shall be justified. So we've proved that this morning, right? Because none of us can keep the law. Does that mean that the Old Testament law that God gave, that it was a bad thing? No. It wasn't a bad thing because it's a benchmark so that we can know our success. We can know. Now some of us, let's see a show of hands. How many of you have kept some of the Ten Commandments? Some of the Ten Commandments. That's good. That's good. So, and you kept them. Why? Because you know that it's the basis or foundation. It's the benchmark for God's righteousness. You've kept them because you know it's important to God. But we failed in some points, but we are successful in others. One of the things that I know when I became your pastor, there was a few of you that were afraid that, we're letting a Baptist in our midst, you know. And I could literally see some of you shaking, you know. And see how nice I've turned out to be. But you didn't know, you know, what I believed or how I believed, you know. And hopefully over the last 5.5 years, you've come to understand that I was never looking, upon becoming your pastor, I was never looking to divide. I was never looking to hurt you or to confuse you. I wanted to build together, which I still do, build together on common ground to be effective witnesses for the Lord. You're not only in our community here, but building your families and your friends, at your workplaces, at your schools, wherever you might be. We want to build together for the Lord to be that all in Him. The song we sing, to God be the glory, that's what it's all about. It's not about my success or my wants or my needs or your success or your wants or your needs. It's got to be about Jesus. And we've got to do more than just say that it's about Jesus. We've got to mean it. We've got to mean it. I get caught up so many different times. I look back over the years and things that I've got upset about. And I think back and go, why did I get so frustrated about that? That was stupid for me to get that aggravated or that frustrated or that this or that about that. And I said, you know, God, forgive me for that. But I've got to want that forgiveness. I've got to ask for that forgiveness. And I've got to move on from that and do what God wants me to do. Or I subject myself to the bondage that Satan wants to hold me in. I shake my head sometimes. I shake my head a lot of times, actually. Because when I go up against the devil, I feel like I'm going in unarmed sometimes. But I know that by God's word, by the power of God's word, by the power of God's spirit, I've got everything I need. What is it we say every day when we leave this building, walk with the King and be of good cheer, Jesus said, because I have what? I have overcome the world. He's done it. And it's by our faith in Him and the power and of His resurrection and the things that He has done that causes us, our faith, to grow and to be effective witnesses for Him. At the end of chapter 2, this was my Uncle Clyde's, his life verse. He was taken from us, oh gosh, it's been, I think it was 1995, July. Late June 1995, perhaps 94, he was taken from us. He was murdered on his way to help somebody there out in Arizona. This was his life verse. He says, I am crucified with Christ, Galatians 2:20. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. You know, if that won't bring us to our knees thinking that Jesus Christ gave himself for me, each one of us can say he gave himself for me. That's what it's about. He loves you. He died for you. He rose again for you. And if we listen and we hear God as he tells us and encourages us and uplifts us, as Paul is trying to do with his church in Galatia, knowing that we are bound in Christ. And as Christ goes, we can go. We need to go. We need to focus on that. I'm going to put my needs and my desires and my wants, I want to just shove them aside, and I want to plug into what he wants for me. I want to plug into what he wants for St. John's as a church. I want to plug into what he wants for Crown Point and Northwest Indiana and for our country as a whole, our state and our country. Plug into what he wants. Well, there's a battle going on, folks. There's a battle going on for the souls of so many. When Jesus told his disciples at one point that the harvest fields are white. I mean, we've got farmers in our church. We've got folks that know what a white harvest field is all about. When you see that field, you know it's time to bring the crops in. You know it's time to harvest the corn and the soybeans and the wheat or whatever it is. You know that it's time, and there's a time of harvest. And we see out there, is the analogy that Jesus is uses here, is there's souls that are just ready to receive Christ, but somebody's got to tell them. Somebody's got to be the example. Somebody's got to step up and show them the way, show them who the truth, and show them who the life is with their walk and their testimony. It's got to be you. It's got to be me. We've got to do it. Too many times in the churches across America, somebody says, well, you know, let so-and-so church down the road, let them do it. Let the Reformed church down the street, they can lead people to Jesus. We just want to come in and have a good time. And it's not what it's about. It's about us. If we've got that relationship with Jesus Christ, we've got to plug into what Jesus wants us to do. We've got to listen to God. Listen to him. I'm crucified with Christ. I think I've... Several years ago, there was a movie made, I think it was Mel Gibson or somebody made it, the one about Christ being crucified there. The Passion is what it was called, right? I have not watched the movie. I've read the book. The aspect of thinking about driving nails in hands, thrusting swords in sides. I mean, the things that Jesus went through with the cat of nine tails ripping the flesh off of his back. I mean, those things just tear me to the core of my heart. Thinking that he did that for me. For me. and I get too obstinate to do this or to do that. When he calls me to do it, he did that for me. He gave it all so that I could have life and have it more abundantly. So that I could win. So that I could rejoice. So that I could be his child. Be his child. No man is justified by the law in the sight of God. The just shall live by faith. We've had some good discussions in the Bible study group over the years. Chuck's always been a blessing. He always would ask these questions about, you know, what is faith and what is this and how can we know this and know that? Chuck always keeps me on my toes. Faith is the substance of things that we hope for. The evidence of things that we can't necessarily see is what the book of Hebrews tells us. We hope in him. What is our faith in? We can have faith in a lot of things. You can have faith in me. You can have faith in one another. And we'll, at some point, we're going to let you down. Whatever faith that we have in Jesus Christ, the one that we're crucified with in the flesh, he is the one that faith in him, we can always listen to him and he will always bring us home. Always bring us home. Do you know him today? Are you following him today? Are you growing in him today? I think Paul has addressed all of those things in the verses Bonnie read for us so well today. My prayer, my hope for you is if you're not, start today. Start today. If you're a Christian, start today. Say, God, I want to be a little bit better today than I was yesterday. And don't just say that. You put a plan in action. I want to spend more time in prayer. I want to spend more time in your word. God, I want to get to know you better. I want to get to know your plan for me personally. I want to be your servant, Lord. I want to be crucified with Christ. I want to live in him. Can we do that? If you've never trusted him as your Savior, you need to admit that you're a sinner. You need to believe that Jesus Christ did indeed die for you. That he did. If we confess our sins to him, the Bible tells us he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Just one sin will send us to hell. But Jesus paid it all. Laura played that song for us last week. He's paid it all. All to him we owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow. You know him today? Have you received him today? If you belong to him, are you growing in him today? That's our hope. That's our challenge as we listen to the Lord. Amen? Amen. All right, let's see here. What do we got next? 254, what can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Well, let's do the first and the last. Stretch your legs if you want to. 1 and 4. We'll take some prayer requests. this time. We've got my daughter Melanie from somewhere in North Carolina. Well, she called me yesterday. I guess her little one Maddie has been sick. She got some kind of virus called RSV for kids. So she asked me if I had little Maddie to our prayer list. She's a bundle of joy to her mama. So let's pray for little Maddie today. And we have others. We talked with Audrey. Persinger is at home. She's doing still in recovery with medication for the infection for her foot. So if you do feel up to it or think of it, give her a call and just a word of encouragement to her. Who else? Bobby, do you have your hand up? So your friend Marcia passed away. Family, friends that we can pray for that she had family in all?
Yes. Okay. She has family.
Okay.
She has two boys.
Okay, let's pray for Marcia's family. Okay, Bobby. Thank you, Bobby. Who else? Mark?
I got praise. I got a message from my son Jack. He said he's hours away from heading home, coming back from overseas on his deployment.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Jack coming home. Coming home. Thank you for sharing that with us. We continue to pray for those who are serving so faithfully in our military. Norma?
Our children are back in Phoenix safely after 8,000 miles of travel.
Wow. So good to have Don and Ann with us. Don and Ann, they're probably watching today, or we'll be watching later maybe. They're probably asleep now, exhausted after that drive. But it's so good to have them and to celebrate your birthday with them last week. And speaking of Norma, I dropped in to visit the other Norma, Rubel, this past Wednesday. Spent a little time with her. She is doing well. And she sends her love to everybody. Just keep her in prayer. She continues to recover. And her son Dan was there too. Dan had a heart attack several weeks ago when he was driving back from Minnesota, their property there. And he had a stent put in, and he is doing well too. So I got to kill two birds with one stone. Got to see him and spend a little time with him and with Norma as well. So she. It's going to take a little time, she said, she thought, before she's able to be back, but she's watching online as we send her the service via email.
Amen.
Who else? Who else? Yes, sir.
Have a joy.
We know the downside of this, though, too, Bob, though, so you can't butter me up here with this. We know at some point you're looking to move to the Indianapolis area, but we're just going to enjoy them and love on them as long as they're here. We'll still love on them as long as they're here, period, but even after they go. But, you guys have been a blessing to us. We thank you for everything that you've done and everything you continue to do, and we just pray the Lord lead you. To the right house, the right place with family and around, and just enjoy the blessings. Thank you, then. We're happy for you. Who else? Who else? Anything online?
Yeah. Robin Becker's asking for prayers for her as she struggles in missing sleep.
Okay. Keep Robin in our prayers. Who else? He is online. Okay. Hey, Don! All right, good deal. So blessed to have them with us. All right, Robin, we're praying for you too. She's missing Steve. That is, I can't imagine what she has gone through, but God bless her. Let's lift her up. Who else? unspoken. By the show of hands, God sees your hands and your hearts. Let's take a moment for silent prayer. Then I will pray, and then we'll recite the Lord's Prayer together before we receive communion this morning. Dear Lord God, we thank you for this day that you blessed us with, and Lord, we just ask that you meet us at the point of the needs here with these that have been brought before you, Lord. My little granddaughter Maddie, that your hand will be upon her. We continue to pray for Audrey's healing, Lord, with her foot, and as Bobby has asked prayer for her friend Marcia that passed away, Lord, for her family and the circumstances there. You know that Robin is going through the same thing. She's missing Steve, Lord. At this point, we pray that you just touch her, and we move with our visit with Norma Rubel and her son Dan. God, we're just grateful that they're both improving and doing well, and we continue to pray, Lord, that you'd lift them up. We're thankful for the joys that Mark has given with his son Jack. Lord, headed home here, Lord, headed home. We just praise you for that. Keep him safe, Lord, in his travels. And be upon him. We're grateful for Bob and Irene, Lord, and everything that they mean to us here, Lord. They've been such special friends, and they'll continue to be that, Lord. Wherever you take them, wherever you lead them, and God, just your hand be upon them. But we're grateful for the sale of their home, and Lord, for the business, and how you've worked that out for them so that they can move on to this next chapter in their amazing lives. We ask that you meet us at the point of our needs, Lord, for the unspoken requests, and be with us as we observe communion today, remembering what you did for us. In Jesus' name, amen. God's people said together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. 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 Thank you, ushers. You come at this time. Those watching online, we appreciate your help and support. And the financial venue, too, if you're able to. There's a giving tool. It is on the Facebook page. It's on the church website as well. And also, anything mailed here to the church will get properly handled in that way, too. We thank you for your help and support. Thank you, ushers. Come on. Thank you. here at St. John's. We pray that you bless our upcoming stewardship campaign, Lord, that together, Lord, we do make a difference. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, ladies. Church Council will be assembling here. Go ahead and be seated. Since the pandemic, communion's been just a little bit different. So we're offering the opportunity. And I just want to say, if you're watching online and if you have any of the older communion cups, don't use them. Throw them away. They expired earlier last month, so last month of the last. So if you've got any of the older prepackaged cups, just throw them out. You need to come by the church and pick up some of the new ones. They've got this fancy little cellophane stuff on them. But these are good till next May or June. I forget whatever's on the box in there. So we're keeping those. But who would? It's when you guys are ready, go ahead and come. I will give these to Mr. Haig, and if you would like one of the pre-packaged communion cups, I mean, it's got two layers of cellophane, one for the wafer to remove it, and then a second tab of cellophane removes for the juice. So you want to remember the laws of physics and gravity still apply, so you want to be holding it this way, trying to take it off, and hold it upright and be careful with it, or it'll spill all over you. Okay? So if you would like a pre-packaged communion cup, just slip up your hand right now. Pre-packaged. Anybody? No? Okay. Okay. All right. Everybody's regular, didn't you? Okay. All right. We take great care to try to properly prepare all of these things. Ask God's blessing upon the bread that represents Jesus' body, which was broken for us. Father God, as we prepare for this ceremony, let us search our hearts and see if there's anything, Lord, between you and us, Lord, that we need to confess, we need to bring to light. God, help us to do that, to clean our hearts before you as we eat this bread that represents the broken body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's do it together in remembrance of him. Ushers, go ahead.
Thank you.
Jesus took the bread in the upper room with his disciples. He said, "This bread represents my body, which will be broken for you. As often as you eat it, do it in remembrance of me." Amen. In like manner, he took the cup. Represent the blood of Jesus Christ that's been spilled for us. Let's ask God's blessing upon the blood, the juice rather, that represents his blood today. Father God, we thank you for the symbolism of your precious blood. We thank you for the atoning power that it has. We ask that as we observe this remembrance, Lord, and guide and direct our paths, us with your spirit. Forgive us where we fall short. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There with his disciples, Jesus, after he'd broken the bread, he took the cup and he said, "This cup represents my blood, which will be spilled for you. Let's drink today in remembrance of him." Amen. Amen. You stand with me. Let's recite our prayer of thanksgiving. It's in the bulletin together. Give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Amen. Thank you, gentlemen, for your service today. Remain standing. We're going to turn to 473. We have heard the joyful sound. And that sound says what? Jesus saves. It's what it's all about. First and last. See us and meet us at the point of our needs. Walk with us, Lord. Help us. Lord, I know I'm off the weak sometimes. Forgive me where I fail you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Walk with the King and be of good cheer, Jesus, that I overcome the world. God bless you.
right, we're going down.
Thank you.
Just for a minute.
Just for a minute. Where are we playing this brat? Some other folks that used to go here and underneath that. So.
Fair enough.
Yeah. Thank you.
You got it. Thank you.